Hello everyone, welcome to this series of interviews of CyEn on the topic of cybersecurity. Today, for a change, we will interview ourselves. You have me, Eva Tasheva, co-founder and cybersecurity lead at CyEn, and Eva Saeva, cybersecurity consultant at CyEn, and we would share with you the latest updates and information of what the NIS, Network Information Security 2 Directive, is about. Eva, what is NIS 2 actually?
Hello, everybody. Hello, Eva. Thank you for organizing this this conversation today. I think it's very important that we talk about NIS2 as it came into force last week on the 16th of January 2023. So we need to provide information what it is about. So the very general terms, we have the actual objective of the directive, which is to achieve a high common level of cybersecurity across the union. And the directive applies to both the member states and companies. So it means there will be obligations for the member states to implement, and there will be obligations for companies to implement. When we say companies, this time we have SMEs. Some SMEs will be included in the scope of the directive, because we do have a size cap. As regards the company's identification, which means that medium and large companies are going to fall within the scope of this directive. However, we clearly need to have some sectors within which we talk about these newly introduced measures for companies. And we have 11 sectors of high criticality. This time, last time with NIS1, we had 7 sectors, critical infrastructure sectors. Now we have 11, and they include energy, transport, banking, financial market infrastructures, health, drinking water, wastewater, digital infrastructure, ICT service management, public administrations, and space. And we also have other companies, which include domain name service, trust service providers, and providers of public electronic communication networks or services. These all qualify as essential services. Essential services means those will be companies upon which there will be a supervisory regime that is ex post and ex ante. This means that they would need the competent authorities will follow compliance with the directive before and after there might be a possibility of infringement of the directive. Then we have other 7 critical seven critical sectors, which include postal and courier services, waste management, manufacture, production and distribution of chemicals, production, processing and distribution of food, manufacturing, digital providers, and research. And the companies operating within these sectors, and the supervisory regime there would be the GDPR style, so ex post supervisory regime. They're not going to be required to systematically document compliance with the cybersecurity risk management measures, and supervision is going to be triggered upon information of potential infringement of the directive. So in general terms, this is what the NIS2 is about.
And what it means actually for companies, what are these measures that they would have obligation to implement? Those are, let's say, specified in chapter 4, and the title really says it though: cybersecurity risk management and reporting obligations. Now, let's start with the reporting obligations. So this is not something new. We had it in NIS 1. What has changed now is that companies would have a time frame for which they have to report significant cybersecurity incidents. This includes early warning, kind of a pinning to authorities within 24 hours after having become aware of the incident. And then a proper incident notification should be submitted within the 72 hours, again, to authorities. In the meantime, expectation is the companies to also provide updates. And last but not least, a final report of how the incident happened and how it was resolved and what are the findings, lessons learned. This should also be submitted to authorities 1 month after notification. What does that mean? We would have much more information about the incidents that happened in Europe, especially with the extent of the scope of the directive. Eva mentioned the sectors and the companies, many new sectors, many new companies, probably more than thousands of new entities would have these reporting obligations, which means that we would have much better visibility and transparency on what incidents are happening in Europe on cybersecurity. We expect this also to improve the discoverability of incidents. Currently, it takes 212 days. According to IBM, for a company on average to identify a breach, cybersecurity incident. So we expect this time to be reduced due to the legal obligations for reporting. And last but not least, we also expect to see more and more, let's say, to identify this complex puzzle of supply chain attacks. Often, you might not be breached, but your company that is providing services to you or your client might be breached. They notify this to authorities. You realize that you were involved somehow or impacted by the incident. So cyber, very complex and even less prompt to identify supply chain attacks probably would be more visible and we would have more information with this notification requirement. And now, what are the specific security measures? Because cybersecurity risk management is, again, managing security, implementing measures based on the risk. And this is indeed very well defined in the directive that companies that fall in the scope should have appropriate and proportionate technical, operational, and organizational measures to manage the risk for their operation or for the provision of their services to prevent or minimize the impact of incidents on the recipients of their services and on their services. So here again, we see clearly risk management approach, security measures, technical, operational, organizational. So everything you could do to minimize the risk, not only for you as a company, as an entity, but also for your clients. And this is, again, very important part of the new directive is that it also introduced requirements for the supply chain cybersecurity. It is not only a requirement for you to, as an entity falling under scope, to implement security measures, but also to ensure that your suppliers implement security measures as well. And we expect also supply chain attacks to continue to grow on the attacking side. Our hope is that with this obligation, we would increase the protection from the side of the companies. And now, what other measures are there? Yes, what is specifically this proportionate measures that the directive sets? On the one hand, it is encouraged that companies would have their management approve all the risk management policies. So there is strong management buy-in, management support requested, as well as training for both for management to be able to execute these functions properly, to understand the cybersecurity risk. They also need to receive cybersecurity training and awareness, and to also ensure that this training and awareness is provided to their employees. And here, it's a point that's also embedded in the directive as one of the minimum requirements that companies should have. And those minimum requirements are taking the kind of all-hazard approach on protection of the cyber space, but also the physical environment of the companies. And I will list you what are the at least what are the minimum requirements set in the directive. Those include policies on risk analysis and information system security, incident handling, business continuity, supply chain security. And here again, we touch upon the point transferring the obligation also to your suppliers. So you have to take this into consideration already today, even if the directive comes into force in 2024, to be able to strike and to include this requirement in your contractual arrangements. What next? Security network and information system acquisition, development and maintenance, including vulnerability handling and disclosure. Very important point, vulnerability handling and disclosure. Remember this, you would see more and more legislation coming with this requirement. So it's a pinpoint that everyone should invest in already. Policies and procedure to assess the effectiveness of cybersecurity risk management. It's not about putting directives, it's also about measuring the performance of these risk management measures. Basic cyber hygiene practices and cybersecurity training, mandatory. Policies and procedures regarding the use of cryptography, human resource security, access control policies, and asset management, very, very essential part of cybersecurity. And last but not least, let's say more technical part here, they also include the use of multi-factor authentication or continuous authentication solutions. So here we make this strong authentication a regulatory requirement. And those are very, for companies that have high maturity, those are typical investment areas. So those are the points that each company normally should have already, but many companies don't yet have proper security in place. And most of those companies we identify as SMEs. So those are the smaller companies, new entrants on the market that try to quickly build a company, to build a product, service, to serve the market. And those are also with limited resources. And as Eva mentioned, all these obligations would now apply to many medium and large companies. So this would require significant investment, but the directive comes not only with obligations, but also with tools. And Eva, will you share with us what are the tools for SME that are included in the directive?
Yes. SMEs this time make quite some significant part of the directive. And they are very important because they do represent 99% of businesses in the EU. And the directive acknowledges the fact that SMEs are very, very important in terms of cybersecurity, in terms of the supply chain. You even mentioned a few minutes ago. So the directive introduces new measures. It encourages, for instance, the member states to appoint points of contact, to have points of contact for the SMEs to contact in case they will need support, assistance. It also encourages the member states to strengthen the cyber resilience and cyber hygiene baseline of SMEs. And this is supposed to be included in their strategies because the NIS directive also encourages member states to adopt a cybersecurity strategy. And not all of the member states' strategies today have acknowledged the importance of the SMEs in the supply chain and in general when we talk about cybersecurity. And so this is supposed to be part of their reviewed strategies. We do need to acknowledge the fact that loads of SMEs today do not have, as you've mentioned, Eva, do not have the necessary budget. So we have budgetary issues we don't have the know-how and competences, skills of the larger companies. And those SMEs are more clearly could fall victims of a cyber attack more easily. And when we talk about ransomware, there has been a rise in ransomware attacks in the last few years. And some of these companies, some of these SMEs, they would rather pay a ransomware if they have fallen victim of a cyber attack than to invest in cybersecurity measures, cyber risk management, prior to, you know, any such thing happening. This is clearly because of budgetary issues. And even though the fact that you've paid your ransomware, that does not necessarily mean that you get all your data recovered. Again, this is still the reality for loads of SMEs. And last but not least, also NIS2 is going to be involved in this, and it's got to include general an assessment on the general level of cybersecurity awareness and cyber hygiene of, level of SMEs in its biannual report on the state of cybersecurity of the union. So we do have a lot of importance has been put on the role of the SMEs in this directive. So loads of companies need to pay attention, thousands more companies, as opposed to NIS1 that was adopted back in 2016.
SMEs are particularly interesting, and you mentioned NIS2. The role of NIS2 already is very strong in creating awareness and supporting cyber hygiene measures, which we saw now are mandatory for those companies. Mm-hmm. Keep an eye on NIS2 website. You would see a lot of tools for SMEs also to improve their cybersecurity, to measure their cybersecurity. I personally participate in their working group on enterprise security, focused very much on supporting SMEs. So there is more to come. Yeah. Do follow NIS2, do follow us, and you would hear more about how to implement the directive as well as how you could improve your cybersecurity.